Good day, and once again a happy new year. In advance, happy Sankranti and Pongal also to you. Today, we are here with a very, very unusual topic. If you have seen, if you go through the list of all the topics that we have covered over the years, this I think stands out as something very, very unusual and very unexpected also to a lot of people. The interesting thing is that this topic came about when I discussed with two or three friends of mine who are all men. In fact, one of them said that women ask, why is it that men do not have menstruation, and why is it that men do not suffer from PMS and all these? Why is it that only ladies have to suffer? And he said, who said men don't suffer? We suffer because of the mood swings of the women. Then they have PMS and all these things. So who understands our pain or our disturbance? As it happens with any ailment or anything which is disturbing, it is the person, the patient, the individual who is going through it, who always gets the sympathy. Very rarely does the caregiver get any sympathy. So that is where it stands. I think today's topic, it should be as useful or as interesting to men as it should be to women. Because men who are partners of women, you know, who are fathers of women, who are even sons of women who have not come to the menopausal age, they all live together and they have to go through these emotional ups and downs and the relationship issues and all these things, isn't it? So let me first start with understanding the basic thing. PMS, as we say, is called premenstrual syndrome. That means before the menses, before the period comes, the last few days, there is a syndrome called PMS. It has been recognized over the ages since a very long time, but somehow it has not been given any significance. The reason is that the disturbance that takes place, or the worry, or the issue that happens, is purely mental or emotional. It is not physical. Anything which is physical immediately attracts attention of people, and people start looking at things and start getting worried about it and all that. If it is mental, emotional, people tend to ignore it. And that's the reason why even women who do suffer from premenstrual syndrome, very often they neglect it. They just don't bother to understand it in depth and thereby make efforts to see what can be done about it. And when they don't do it, they're near and dear, be it men or women, they also go through a lot of tension or a lot of unpleasantness or uneasiness, etc. Now, what happens? Very briefly, at the biological level, what happens is that there is a hormonal up and down before the time period, when before the period comes in. When that hormonal ups and downs come in, by now I think all of us should be aware that it leads to mood swings. It happens not just in premenstrual syndrome. For example, you know, people who suffer from ups and downs in their blood sugar levels, they also go through mood swings, and they hardly recognize it themselves, and nobody else recognizes it. Same thing with thyroid. A person having hypothyroid can go into severe depression, and depression which can be cured very easily by setting right the thyroid levels. But yet people don't understand. In most cases, people do not understand the connection of the mind and body. So that's the reason why some of these things, which are apparently purely biological, the emotional part of it is ignored. Let me in fact start with, puberty. Even today in the 21st century, among educated people, there are girls who come to puberty and they start having menstruation and they go through so much of turmoil and there's nobody to guide them except to tell them how to take care of themselves physically. Nobody guides them how to take care mentally. There are young girls who can manage very comfortably, but for the little discomfort of the bleeding, nothing happens to them. But there are also girls who go through wild mood swings. And those are the ones when they say something like, you know, I'm having so much of problem because of my period. Other people say, everybody has. All women have it. Why are you making such a fuss about it? That's very cruel. That's very insensitive. But that is real. Let me tell you that. So that was the reason why, after discussing with a few people, getting some inputs and all that, I thought, let me have this topic today. I know it's not a very popular topic and not too many people would actually log in. But as I've always been saying, myself personally and our entire team in Banjara never looks at numbers. If one human being's life is enriched, changed for the better, we are happy. We are not looking to see whether these programs of ours go viral and whether there is, you know, those so many millions of followers and all these things. Numbers do not matter to us. So whoever is interested, if they log in, if they listen to us, they will benefit from us. And my request to those of you who are logging in and listening to this is, please spread the word. As you know, these programs do not end at 3 p.m. They remain. They remain on Banjara Academy's Facebook page. So if you just log into Facebook and you click like to Banjara Academy, you will keep getting the notifications of what are the topics, what are the, you know, sessions that we have had. And later on also you can go for it. The same thing, it is also available on YouTube. So those who miss out, if you, anybody at any time suddenly comes up with this issue and says that, you know, I have this concern, you can tell them that there is this session which happened where you can get a few important, you know, tips. Okay. Now let's come down to the main issue. What happens to some of them? See, human behavior is always like that, isn't it? Even for physical ailments, one person has high fever and he is very much functional. Another person has high fever and he is groaning and moaning and lying down on bed. You can't compare the two, no? The same way you cannot compare two people who are going through emotional pain. So there are some women who go through PMS and just bear up with it and then ignore it and they move on. There are some women who suffer very badly. And like I said, their near and dear also suffer. Now, what is the suffering? What happens? There are so many areas in which, you know, these things happen. So let's start with what are the symptoms, possible symptoms. I'm not saying every female goes through these symptoms, but there are a lot of possible symptoms. And if you're aware of all the possible symptoms, you can check out which one is applicable to you, which one needs to be taken care of. So I made out this list as Anis, as usual, has converted it into a small presentation, that is the symptoms of PMS or premenstrual syndrome. What are the possible symptoms that a woman or a girl may go through? There is a change in the sex drive, which if she is, you know, a married person or having a sexual partner, it can affect, at least momentarily, it can affect the relationship between the two. And on the long term, it can affect in many, many different ways. Feeling of anxiety, you know, that uneasiness, what's going to happen, some sort of sadness or depression. Quite a few people go through this, but because it lasts most of the time for just 2-3 days, they forget about it when it is gone and they say, okay, I'm back to normal. Oh, it was just a quick passing phase. But a quick passing phase does not happen month after month for years and decades. That's why we need to take cognizance of it. You can have something called a brain fog. That means having trouble concentrating. It is like a fog has come into your brain. You're trying to think, you're trying to focus, you're trying to concentrate, and it is not happening. This does happen to quite a few people. There could be, for example, an increase or a decrease in appetite. There can be a craving for food. And people will say, what's wrong with you? You know, you just had your food. Why are you craving for it? And things like that. Taking frequent naps, or the other way around, that is, having trouble sleeping. Some people lose their sleep. Their sleep becomes very restless and very troublesome. Or there are those who feel drowsy and every now and then they feel like taking a nap. There's an overall diminished interest in a lot of activities. These are some of the areas which we need to be aware of. As I said, all of them may not apply to every person, but whichever are applicable, they are real. They need to be looked into. They need to be overcome or minimized. And the sad part is that even though there are ways and means of doing it, we do not give enough significance, because these are not, you know, life-threatening diseases, or these are not physically painful. And that's the reason why it happens, it moves off, and that's the end of the thing. There are times when I have had women, you know, grown-up women, I'm not talking about teenagers and all that, women who have been through certain experiences of life and have come to middle age or whatever, when they come and say that I love my husband, I have an excellent relationship with my husband, we get along very well together, but once in a while, we have a fight. And when we have a fight, we get so nasty with each other, we say the most horrible things, and you know, it looks so bad. But it passes off. And then we get back and we become friendly. But then it's been happening so often that I thought maybe I'll talk to somebody and try to find out, when we both love each other, when we have such a good understanding, why is it that periodically every now and then we are having this fight? And if I ask that lady, does it happen on particular days of the month? She says, what, you're an astrologer or something? I say, no, I'm asking you. Does it happen at particular days of the month connected to your menstrual cycle, just before menstruation? And some of them, it's like a tube light opening over their head, and they say, oh yeah, I never thought of that. What's the connection? I said, the connection is PMS. We have to start educating people at that level sometimes. And more interesting, if I'm counseling a couple, and I'm talking to the husband and I say that, you know, from whatever I have discussed with your wife, it looks as though she goes through PMS every month. And therefore, she becomes upset, she becomes irritable, she goes through all these things. So, can I request you that on those particular days, try to become more sensitive, more gentle, more understanding? It will pass off within no time. And you know, some husbands, the reaction that they've given me is, Dr. Ali, now you have given her a license to fight with me. Every month she'll have a fight with me, and then she'll say it is PMS and you keep quiet. But that's not true. It is something which is happening. It's like if your partner has, you know, had a sprain or broken the leg, and you're saying, no, you have to walk. You can't give excuses for that. You have to be working. You have to be walking. See how easily we recognize physical symptoms, but how difficult it is to recognize mental or emotional, you know, symptoms. Generally, people who go through severe PMS symptoms, it becomes like a vicious cycle, you know, month after month, when it goes on and it is unresolved, they start going lower and lower and lower. And as a vicious cycle, it pulls down their whole quality of life. At one point, some of them feel unhappy. They find themselves dissatisfied with life, and they find themselves getting into extreme mood swings, intolerance, getting impatient, feeling that nothing is going right in my life. Okay, now this is just the overall thing of regular PMS. Let me also quickly bring you to your attention that there is a phenomenon which is definitely connected to PMS, but which is much more severe. Thankfully, not too many, but there are women who suffer from premenstrual dysphoric disorder, which is referred to by medical people as PMDD. Premenstrual dysphoric disorder. It is a severe and an extension of PMS. Those who suffer from this really suffer badly. The dividing line is very thin, but here are some of the basic symptoms which, when a person has gone beyond PMS and into PMDD, what to look out for. Extreme mood shifts, not just normal irritation or normal, you know, uneasiness, but extreme mood shifts can happen during those days. There can be a lasting irritability or anger that may affect other people. See, as I said, a couple, they fight for 2-3 days and then they get over, another 2-3 days and they're back to normal. But there can be anger which can affect, you know, relationship on a longer term basis, on a cumulative basis. A feeling of sadness, despair, and in extreme cases, even, you know, feelings of ending my life or not wanting to live, thinking in terms of suicide. Some people go through feelings of tension, anxiety, their stress levels go up very high, as though life is just, you know, not worth it, or what's happening in life and things like that. In extreme cases, some people go through what we call as panic attacks. That means the person just starts, you know, shouting or screaming or getting very restless, jumping up and down, walking up and down, not knowing what to do with oneself. Mood swings, I've already mentioned. And in the case of PMDD, there can be a lot of crying also. Lack of interest in daily activities and relationships. And quite important, trouble in thinking or focusing. They can't think straight. And that makes them so upset. They say, what's wrong with me? Why am I not thinking straight? Why am I not being able to focus? Anyway, just wanted to make you aware that these are the symptoms which plain PMS starts with. And if it goes into extreme cases, it can be, as I said, PMDD, etc. So, of course, you know that when a person comes to menopause, that time, you know, all these problems get away. So sometimes people are just waiting, you know, that, okay, I'm already so many years old and once I get my menopause, I'll be free from this. But why allow life to go down for years and years till you come to the menopause? I'll give you some very simple tips on how you can either avoid or minimize the impact of PMS. This is not from me, this is from experts who have been dealing with the issue for many, many years. So they are the ones who have said this. Take it or leave it, I'm not saying that this is my theory. Surprisingly, something as simple as drinking water. Just before you come to that stage, increase your intake of water, and during PMS, try to drink as much water as possible. And similarly, in those days, avoid foods and drinks which contain too much of caffeine, high levels of salt or sugar. And if you start doing that a few days before PMS, you will find that you are able to face and the symptoms will be much less. In the same way, if you can ensure before you come to the PMS stage that you are getting adequate, regular and good quality sleep, that is also known to bring down the effect or to minimize the impact of the PMS. Of course, if you look at, you know, from the point of view of the medical fraternity, doctors sometimes even prescribe antidepressants for people going through this. Sometimes they prescribe anti-inflammatory drugs, diuretics, which help in the urinary system, and in certain cases, they have also prescribed hormonal contraceptives. Now, this, of course, is purely a medical thing. I have no comments on this. You have to listen to an expert and get the correct advice from the professional. As far as our routine from a day-to-day basis, from the basic listing is concerned, how would you, try to deal with this situation? Plan around this monthly cycle. And I request this not only to the person suffering, but also to the family members. Whatever planning, we generally plan, no? These days we'll have some nice cookout, we'll have some picnic, these days we'll go and attend some function, or we'll go out shopping, or whatever it is. When you're planning a few days or a few weeks ahead, try to take into account the aspect of when the person in the family is going to go through PMS. And on those days, try to minimize any activity, any interaction which can be troublesome and which can cause some sort of disturbance or relationship issues. Similarly, schedule time to help out with daily chores. Let's say the person going through PMS is the homemaker and she does the cooking. Generally, you will find that she's quite committed. She's very responsible. She, many of them even enjoy cooking and they take it up and they do the cooking. But on these days, can you reduce the impact? Can you maybe order from outside? Or can you minimize the amount of time that she has to spend in the kitchen and to do the cooking? Just do it very basic or fundamental, or somebody else helps out, or somebody else does the cooking, or whatever it is. We also need to plan activities to relax. A relaxed mind brings down the effect of PMS. Now, how do you relax? Again, I don't have a standard answer to it. Human beings are so different. Everybody has their own relaxation techniques. You find your own. Somebody feels very relaxed by prayer or by chanting mantras or listening to some spiritual discourse. Some people relax by music. Some people relax by gardening. Some people relax by creative things like, drawing or painting or doing some pottery work or anything of creative nature. But I think you owe it to yourself. Whether there's PMS or not, whether you are a woman or a man, it doesn't matter. You should find ways and means of relaxing. And this I am telling you from the holistic angle of your entire life. If you want to lead a quality of life which is good, where relationships are good, where health is good, where you don't land up with heart attacks and all these horrible things, you do need to know what are the ways and means by which you can relax. And that you can come to know only by practice. And practice for how long? Minimum 3 to 4 weeks. So, okay, I decided that for relaxation, I'll do gardening. I've got a little patch of open land, or I've got a balcony in which I can put pots. I want to do gardening. Do it. Not for one day or 1 week. Do it diligently and regularly for 1 month. 3 to 4 weeks is the minimum that you have to spend to know whether this is affecting you or not. And once you know that, yes, this is, helping me, keep it in mind. And keep practicing it as often as you can. The other thing is, have people around you who are understanding and who are supportive. If at that time you have people who do not understand you, let's say you've got an adolescent child in the house who's a little naughty or who's a little rebellious or whatever. During these days, the relationship between that child and the parent or whoever is going through PMS can really deteriorate and it can leave an impact. So can you, if you are aware of the PMS factor, can you ensure that you will have people around you who are caring, sensitive, who will give support. Maybe for 2 days I'll go off to my mother's house and relax over there and come back, whatever it may be, or I'll go and attend some retreat where I get some meditation or do some yoga or whatever comes to you. But if you are in the company of people who understand you, who give you emotional support, it is a really useful way to pass through this period, which, as I said, if it is not dealt with properly, can have long-term effects. The emotional turmoil of PMS may go away in 2-3 days. But the long-term effect it leaves on relationships, if you had an argument, if you had a fight, if you had some misunderstanding with somebody who is close to you, the impact does not go away. Also, by the way, while generally PMS lasts for only 2-3 days, please be aware that for some women, it is much longer than that. As I keep saying, human nature, human attributes are so unique and so unpredictable. You cannot say, okay, 3 days, PMS, done, finished. No. Some people, it lasts much longer than that. Avoid activities which are very challenging or difficult. If you have to fill in your, let's say, taxation forms, or if you have to study for something very important, or give a presentation in your office, or hold a party for some very, very important people who are going to come and you have to cook everything and do everything, try to avoid those type of activities, at least during that period when that PMS is there. So in a nutshell, these are some of the tips which I gathered, which I collected from various sources, and I thought I will give you. But PMS being something which is of so much significance and so misunderstood, I thought I will also, bring to your attention some good books which are, available. There is a book called A Woman's Guide to Feeling Good All Month. A Woman's Guide to Feeling Good All Month. The author is Susan M. Lark. S-U-S-A-N, Susan M. Lark. L-A-R-K. For those who suffer from the severe PMDD, as I mentioned to you, there's a book called The PMDD Phenomenon: Breakthrough Treatments for Premenstrual Dysphoric Disorder. It's been written by Dr. Diana Dell. Diana, D-E-L-L, Diana Dell. It's published by Contemporary Books. There's another simple book which is called Self-Help for Premenstrual Syndrome. Self-Help for Premenstrual Syndrome by Michelle Harrison. M-I-C-H-E-L-L-E, Michelle Harrison, H-R-R-I-S-O-N. There's also a very interesting book that I came across recently, An Ayurvedic and Modern Overview of Premenstrual Syndrome. It has been written by Dr. Megha Rathore and Dr. Manjushri Karkare. This is an Indian book based on Ayurvedic principles. These are some of the things which I thought I will just share with you in case you want to do further reading or get up onto it. And with that, I end the first half. Sonal is right here with me to give you a quick update on what's happening, and I take my 1 minute break.
Good afternoon, everyone. Lovely to see everybody's comments and waiting to listen from Alif. I would say this topic is really, really very beautiful, unspoken and misunderstood many a times, as Ali rightly said. And when these syndromes happen, a lot of relationship goes for a toss also, right? So we have to work towards building such an environment where you can freely speak of your needs, right? Good afternoon, Vinita. Right? So relationships, as we say, is such a delicate thing. But if we work towards it and, you know, put efforts or invest in relationships, we can create a wonderful world beyond, around us. And to tell you, to update you what's happening with Banjara, at Banjara, in February 16th, 17th and 18th of February, we have Manthan Camp. You all love Manthan, no? Manthan Camp on relationships. So I thought, you know, today is the perfect time to tell, because when premenstrual syndrome comes, there's so much of relationships also needs to be addressed. And how can you create that emotional distance? Because if you are with someone where you cannot, you know, deal with your emotions at such times, how do you create that emotional distance? How do you create those boundaries? How do you anticipate changes in relationships and the impact of social media in relationships? All these factors will be in detail spoken by Ali in the Manthan Camp from 16th to 18th of February at Manthan. And you all know where Manthan is, but yet I'll tell. Manthan is in front of DPS North. So that is one thing. Then let me tell you that time and again, I'll remind you that we offer free counseling. So whenever you feel there's lots on your head, you want a venting out place, or you want to speak to someone, or you want to write a mail, or you want to call up and speak to any of the counselors, we offer free counseling. And you want to be that platform to, you know, be that person to take that venting of people and want to help people to give emotional support, then DCS admissions have already started. So you all can spread the word and bring people, more and more people in our world, to create an environment which is conducive for anyone and everyone, and especially for people with difficult times like premenstrual syndromes. And back to Ali to continue, waiting for your question.
Yes, I am back. And we start with Kumar Swami, who says, Namaste Ali and Team Banjara, happy to join on Saturdays. Yes, we are also happy to have you, Mars. Thanks for arranging talks, which makes me get reconnected with Banjara. And we always feel happy to keep reconnecting with our old students and our old associates also. Sridevi says, we get relaxed from listening to Dr. Ali's enlightening session, sir. Thank you so much, Sridevi. You've always been complimenting, and I truly appreciate your compliments. But at the same time, please understand that there should be a number of different activities that you should have, which are all, you know, stress bearing. Yes, you may be listening for an hour every Saturday, and I thank you for it. But at the same time, you should have some regular relaxing activities or relaxing techniques, which should be, if not 7 days of the week, at least 5-6 days of the week. Akila says, thank you, Dr. Ali, for educating us about PMS and PMDD. Yes, Akila, and I want you, please, to spread the word. These are such, you know, sensitive and delicate topics. Nobody wants to talk about it. They want to just ignore it. And, you know, and that's why people who suffer sometimes have to suffer in silence and in loneliness. So whatever topics we take up, even an unusual topic like PMS and all that, when you come across it, please make it a point to bring it up, at least among your close friends, people with whom you're comfortable, and tell them that, hey, this is what I came to know, or this is what I'm, you know, learning about. Why don't we do something about it? And then you see how people benefit from it and how they open out. Okay, Surekha says, how can a husband handle his wife's PMS, especially when at times she uses it as a tool for manipulation? I agree, Surekha. There are all types of human beings, all types of wives, all types of husbands, etc. Right? But the point that is important over here is that if there is a good understanding, if there is a good communication, and the person says that, okay, I know this is the time of PMS and I am going to be sensitive to it. I'm not going to allow any sort of argument or unpleasantness between us. But if you try to manipulate and if you try to tell me you have to do this for me, you have to do that for me, sorry, I'm drawing the line. In fact, this is what we do even with children, no? We pamper our children. We love our children. We give the best to our children. But at the same time, we tell them, no, that beyond this, if you misbehave or if you do something or you try to manipulate me, sorry, I'm not going to melt just because you're trying to put up such a sorry face. I think the same principle applies at the, you know, adult level. And it can be done. It's not very difficult. Sridevi says, cooking and counseling sessions, which I love to listen and learn from others. Yes, sir. So many sweet things in life. See, as I told you, people are so unique. Sridevi enjoys cooking. Some people consider cooking as a chore, as a task, as a responsibility for the family. Now, those people can be given a little freedom, a little, you know, leeway during these PMS days and say, okay, either we'll have some leftovers or somebody else will help in the kitchen or we'll even order from outside. So you give that little relaxation. On the other hand, as Sridevi mentioned just now, for somebody, cooking can actually be relaxing because cooking also is a very creative activity. Similarly, she mentioned that counseling sessions. That is one thing I have been saying regularly since such a long time, that if you are a counselor and you are practicing counseling on a regular basis, we can never determine how many people you have helped as a counselor, but you can definitely note over a period of time how your own quality of life improves, how your life gets enriched by counseling. So obviously that is also a way of relaxing, isn't it? And that is something which I recommend to everybody who's a warm, compassionate and caring person. Vinita says, it's very true. Because of PMS, sometimes few of them are not able to express. And it has a huge impact on relationships. I feel we must learn to respect that a person is going through some things and let it be. That's all it needs, Vinita and all of you. We just let it be. We just say, okay, I know that you're irritable. I know that, you know, you're not in a good frame of mind. Fine. Let it go. You need something, I'll give it to you. You want to manipulate me, I'm not going to give it to you. But I will not be, you know, lured into a discussion, an argument or an unpleasantness. That's all that it needs. Be sensitive. Give that support to whoever in your family is going through such a situation. Sneha says, how do we explain this to our elders, like grandmothers and mothers? They tell they didn't have it and this is just excuses. Yes, Sneha, the main important thing is that life has changed in even one generation, forget about two generations from your grandmother's days. There were so many things which did not happen in their generation, which are happening now. And so many things which happened in their generation, which are not happening now. I know of grandmothers who would say, why do you need a mobile phone? We never had a mobile phone when we were young. So what makes you think that it is absolutely necessary? Sometimes jokingly, I even tell them that, you know, grandma, your father used to go to school in a bullock cart. Do you want to send us also in a bullock cart to school? When you were young, there was no TV. Why do I see you sitting and watching TV so often? You yourself say, no, that there was no TV when you were a child. So why do you need TV now? Times change, situations change, so many things change. Today, if you are having difficulty cooking food at home or something, you can order food and in minutes it comes. In those days, nothing like that was there. Whoever was the homemaker had to jolly well cook the food. So there are positive things, there are developments, there is progress, and we should go by that. The same way, today, because the awareness towards things like PMS has increased and we know that we can do something about it, why should we give up without making that effort? Sridevi says, playing indoor or outdoor games with children sort. Yes, very true. Children themselves are a great relaxation and stress busters. There's no doubt about it. Provided you don't take your role as an elder too seriously. If you start thinking, I have to discipline them, I have to take care of them, I have to protect them, then it becomes more stressful. Go down to that level, become children with them. Of course, protect them here and there when things get bad. But otherwise, play games with them, indoor games, outdoor games, whatever it is. Namina says, I think first it's very important to be aware that I'm having PMS. I'm suddenly feeling irritated. I'm feeling angry for no reason. And then communicate to people around so that they can empathize and handle the woman sensitively. Yes, Namina, in any family, if you make a beginning, like Namina said just now, become aware that I am, you know, suddenly feeling irritated or I'm feeling angry for no reason, and then start telling people and then explain to them how and when this happens, which days of the month and when this thing is happening. You do it for a few cycles, few months, you will realize that everybody gets sensitized to it. And once people get sensitized, it is not difficult to, you know, take care of it. You have a very old person in the family who is diabetic. And the person has to have food on time. Normally, the whole family is busy running around, roaming around, doing whatever it is. So as and when they come, then the lunch is made or dinner is made. But when you become sensitive, that here is one family member who is diabetic. And he needs to eat on time, otherwise things can get very bad for him. So if that is brought to the awareness and it is done for a few days, a few weeks, slowly everybody starts getting into that, you know, sense of responsibility or discipline and all that. And then it becomes very easy. Kumar also says, Ali, can you please throw some light on how to consciously know that now I am relaxed? After doing relaxation techniques, like some external situation may prevail, but the way we see it may differ after relaxation techniques. Yes, you have given the first step towards it. The moment I realize that for the same stimulant or the same external circumstance, earlier I used to get very agitated. Now I seem to be taking it easy. Now it doesn't affect me as much. So automatically, what does that mean? It means that now I'm in a relaxed state of mind. And when I say relaxation, please also remember, it is not just relaxation of the mind or the body, it is relaxation of the mind and body. An unrelaxed body does not allow the mind to be relaxed. And an unrelaxed mind does not allow the body to be relaxed. So we have to take both into account. And that is where, you know, our age-old techniques like yoga, for example, it covers both mind and body. There's so many things. I'm not an expert and I don't want to take time today to go into the depth of that. But each one of you can be aware that you have to find the ways, and your own mind and your body will tell you I'm more relaxed. For example, earlier I used to wake up a little tired. Now I'm waking up fresh. At the end of the day, I used to just feel like jumping into bed. Now I can slowly take it easy and go lie down, relax. So that's how your body tells you. Same thing with your mind. Earlier, I used to get irritable when my child used to be shouting. Now I can accept the shouting. He's a growing child, you know. He will shout once in a while. Yes, I will discipline him, but I'm not going to get affected by it. These are indicators that your mind is getting relaxed. That's how you should do it. Sridevi says, two things, both of which are my favorite. Books and music. I mean, books, I can talk the whole day on it. I give so much importance to reading, particularly now because reading seems to be a dying habit. If we are wrong role models to children, if we do not read as adults, children of 21st century, the digital natives will never pick up the reading habit, and they will miss out on one of the best skills, one of the best assets that human beings have, which originally made us superior to the other living beings. And here we are giving up on that. Similarly, as Naveena says, journaling, spending time in nature, talking to like-minded people, hearing motivational videos, funny videos can all deal with PMS and any form of stress. In fact, journaling, writing down what happened, anything significant that happened to you today, any thoughts that came in. Keep a journal. It need not be a diary which you have to write every day. It can be a journal which you fill in whenever thoughts occur to you. There may be a day when you feel like making 4 entries in the journal. There may be 3 days when you don't have anything significant to write. But as long as you are maintaining that journal and keeping up the habit, that itself is a great thing. Spending time in nature, oh my, that is one of the best possible ways of relaxation. Nature teaches you so many different things. In fact, next month, I'm going to be doing one of these, every life sessions on a Saturday, which is make friends with plants. Normally, what do? We make friends with human beings. Some of us are animal lovers. We make friends with animals. But how many of us make friends with plants? And the question is, how do we do it? Why should we do it? That's what I'm going to be discussing in the third week of February in this same FB Live session. Please check out the list of topics, which is already there on our website, and you'll know which date it is. Kumar Swami also says, Ali, as age advances, should we have to change our relaxation techniques, like cycling may not be relaxing after a certain age? Yes, I agree with you. A lot of activities which we used to do as youngsters, we have to reconsider that. We have to think of how best we can keep changing it. For example, I have a friend who's a great lover of table tennis. He used to play regularly table tennis. As age advances and as he slows down, you know what he has done? He has qualified himself as an umpire for table tennis matches. So he spends time in table tennis. He's umpiring, he's learning, he's interacting with people. And when he feels like, when he is in the mood, he also plays. So see how in every area we can find ways and means to slow down physically and increase the mental involvement in our activities. Naveena says, also, rather than focusing on the symptoms of PMS, being grateful for positive is happening in that moment or period helps a lot. Yes, Naveena, and I'll also add on to the thing about journaling. Whenever something positive is happening, whenever something nice is happening, now my child has learned to draw or to play music. I made a new friend in my neighborhood who seems to be a very potentially interesting person. My back used to give a lot of trouble, but last few days I'm feeling a little relieved and I'm not having those back pains or whatever. So like that, if we start looking at positive things, as Naveena said, that itself is a great relief. It makes us optimistic. It makes us think positively. And when we have issues like PMS, or it could be anything else. It could be a man who's got severe work stress. You know, boss has given him some real challenging work to do. In the next few days, he has to complete it and he's getting very stressed out. All these little things help you to overcome that or to manage that or to be able to tolerate that. As they always say, no, prevention is better than cure. And what do we do with things which you cannot cure? I would still recommend that if somebody is going through PMS on a regular basis and is having a lot of mood swings, try and look at a doctor who is sensitive, who is understanding, who looks at you holistically, not just at the symptoms, and ask that doctor, is there some cure? Something I've already mentioned to you, the possibility of certain medications, but only under, you know, professional medical supervision. So maybe a doctor has something to do. So look at that on one side. At the flip side, remember that what has to be borne. See, there's a very nice proverb which says, pain is inevitable. Pain is inevitable. Suffering is optional. Maybe there is some pain which I cannot relieve, which I cannot overcome, or which I cannot reduce. But whether I'm going to suffer because of that pain is directly under my control. Keep that in mind and move on. In advance, once again, happy Sankranti or happy Pongal. And we shall be meeting again next Saturday with the topic importance of hobbies. And I've given a byline, we all need them. Those of us who do not have hobbies, please do attend next week. I'll also tell you the significance or importance of having hobbies and the advantages, how it really affects your life. So with that, I sign off. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.